This is a type of shower gel called foam burst. It comes out blue, but if you agitate it, it turns into a foam and it changes color from blue to white. This is some water that's been stained a dark green. There's some soap in there. If I shake it, it turns white. This soggy picture of a rhino turns white as it dries. This Pernod turns white when you pour it into water, as does this bath emollient. If you buy a fog machine, you'll be disappointed to discover the only color of fog you can buy is white. Clouds are white. Lots of things are white. Why is that? And what's it got to do with wet t-shirts and Buddha boards? For a while now, I've been trying to figure out how Buddha boards work. A Buddha board is a white piece of card and you can paint on it with water. So a brushstroke of water turns the card black, so you can create artworks. But the artwork you create is temporary because when the board dries, it returns back to its white color. The superficial explanation is quite simple. You have a black piece of card, and then you have a special white coating on top. It's special because it becomes transparent when wet, so it reveals the black color underneath, which explains why you can have more complex images like this color picture of a rhino. You can take any picture you like and coat it with this special layer. But the question is, how does the layer work? Why does it become transparent when wet? And I think I have the answer to that. Let's consider the shower gel to begin with. Why is it blue? Well, if you take white light, and remember, white light is just all the colors of the spectrum mixed together, and you shine it onto the shower gel, then the shower gel absorbs some of the red and green parts of the spectrum, and the blue parts are reflected back into your eyes. Or more correctly, it's scattered in all different directions, some of which ends up in your eyes. Scattering is just reflecting, by the way, except that it's off a rough surface instead of a smooth surface, so it doesn't obey the laws of reflection. Well, either that or the light is bouncing off molecules or particles randomly distributed within a substance, like we've got here with the shower gel. But anyway, that's why the shower gel is blue. So why does it turn white when it foams up? Well, let's take a cross-section through the foam. Because of all those bubbles, you've got all these different surfaces all oriented in different directions. And when light lands on one of these surfaces, two things happen. Some of the light gets reflected, some of it gets transmitted. The transmitted light is refracted, but that's not so important here. The important thing is the light bounces around inside the foam, some of it getting transmitted, some of it getting reflected. And eventually, after this chaotic bouncing around inside the foam, some of it will bounce back out towards your eyes. And crucially, this scattering of light, as it's called, happens to all the colors of the spectrum. So the light that reaches your eyes is that full spectrum of colors mixed together. It's white. And that's why foam looks white. You might think at this point, well, hold on, the shower gel still has that blue dye in it. So when some of the light is transmitted through those thin layers of the shower gel, the red and green parts of the spectrum should get absorbed by that dye and the blue parts scattered. So why doesn't the foam look a little bit blue? And the truth is that, well, yeah, it does. It looks a tiny bit blue. It's just completely overwhelmed by the scattering of all the colors of light through reflection and transmission. And that makes sense because foam is mostly air. Like this big thick chunk of shower gel here looks pale blue. So if you spread that out and make it mostly air, then that handful of very thin surfaces that the light passes through in the foam state isn't going to experience much of that scattering and absorption from the dye itself. Here's another way to think about it. I've got some blue liquid here, and if I move the camera, suddenly it turns completely bright white. Actually, what you're seeing is the reflection of my light source, this light panel here. In other words, you're seeing glare. So by moving the camera, I can go between these two extremes. One way you can see the true color of the liquid, and one way you can't see it at all. What foam does is kind of average out these two extremes. Because the surface of the foam is oriented in all these different directions, there's no one sweet spot where you get glare. You get a little bit of glare from the entire foam surface. And it turns out that when you average out the color of the liquid with the glare of reflection from the light, actually the glare of reflection from the light mostly wins out and the foam is white in appearance. So in simple terms, the reason lots of things are white is because of scattering. It's why clouds are white. But the details are often quite different. For example, the sky is blue for a different reason to shower gel is blue, or at least this shower gel. With clouds, you've got these droplets of water and they're acting like the surface of the foam or the surfaces within the foam. In other words, the light is bouncing around off and in and through those droplets of water in all different directions. Eventually that light finds its way to your eyes and you see it as a white cloud. The example of Pernod turning cloudy when you add it to water is even more interesting. There are these essential oils that are dissolved in the alcohol of the Pernod that aren't soluble in water. So when you add the Pernod to the water, the concentration of alcohol goes down, the essential oils are no longer soluble in that solution, so they drop out of solution and form these tiny droplets. Just like if you have a layer of oil on top of water and you shake it, you end up with droplets of oil suspended in the water. Though in that case, the droplets start to join together into bigger droplets, they rise up to the top, and they all smush together into one big mass of oil. For some reason, that doesn't happen in the case of the aromatic molecules in Pernod. They remain suspended as tiny droplets. They don't join together, and they don't fall or rise. And from what I can tell, nobody knows why. What's all this got to do with the workings of a Buddha board? Well, let's have a look at frosted glass as an intermediary step. Frosted glass is frosted because the surface is rough and not smooth. So when light hits the frosted glass, it bounces off those different facets of the glass that are all oriented in different directions. Otherwise, it scatters. That's why it looks slightly less transparent and slightly more white. What if you could fill in those gaps and smooth out the surface? Well, you can do that with sticky tape. The glue of this sticky tape will fill in all those gaps. And look, the glass is no longer frosted. If you work in an office with cubicles and they're separated by frosted glass and you want to see through the frosted glass, just put some sticky tape up there and you'll be able to see through. This only works because the refractive index of the glue in the sellotape is very similar to the refractive index of the glass. So that when light passes from one substance to another, it's mostly transmitted and it's hardly refracted at all. The same thing happens with fabric. So fabric is made of lots of really thin fibers, all pointing in different directions. And so they scatter light in the same way that foam does. But if you wet fabric, then the water gets in between all the fibers. It fills in all those gaps. And because the refractive indices of water and fabric are much closer together than the refractive indices of air and fabric, it reduces the amount of scattering. Much more of the light simply passes through or is absorbed by the fabric, which is why fabric appears darker when it's wet. It also makes the fabric more transparent, which is why if I pour water on this t-shirt, you can start to see my nipples. So here's my hypothesis about the Buddha board. That coating on top of the black card must be scattering light, and that's why it's white. So three important properties for whatever that coating is. It must be really rough so that it scatters light, and we can kind of see that under the microscope here. It needs to be transparent, which is to say, if the surface wasn't rough, you'd be able to see through it really well. And the third thing is, it probably has a refractive index that's really close to water, so that when you do wet it, the scattering is reduced almost to zero, and you can see right through to that dark layer underneath. I wish I could tell you what that chemical substance is on the surface of the Buddha board, but I can't find it anywhere online. I suspect it's a trade secret, but if you know or you have any ideas, let me know in the comments. One final thought that might be on your mind is, well, not all things that appear white have a roughness to them, like a white car, for example, or a wall that's been painted white. Well, the vast majority of white paint is made white through the addition of titanium dioxide. And titanium dioxide is a crystal that isn't white. It only becomes white when you crush it into a fine powder, of course, because of scattering. Lots of tiny crystals all oriented in different directions, you get scattering. In fact, the refractive index of titanium dioxide is so high that you can add this fine powder as a suspension to a liquid And it will still appear white because the refractive index between these two different things is still quite large, which is why paint still appears white even when it's wet. I've got some more Skillshare course recommendations for you. They're sponsoring this video. You've heard me talk about online video learning before because I had a big change of heart about it. Like these days, I think that it's a really good idea, if you can, to front load your learning with some really quality time with an expert. It could literally be an hour or two, and it's really going to accelerate your improvement as you carry on your own. So I've picked out a few more courses that I think you might get a kick out of. Fundamentals of DSLR Photography, self-explanatory. Creativity and Beer, they've got beer brewing courses. Mesmerize, create mind-bending gifts. This is a great way to learn After Effects because you're doing these like geometric animations. There's some mathematics in there. He does pronounce it GIF, so. Introduction to Aerial Videography. That's good if you're thinking of getting a drone or you've got a drone. I'm thinking of getting one, very exciting. Presentation Essentials. You know, it's amazing how many jobs require presentation skills, but we focus on it very little. Imagine how much better your job would be if you just brushed up on that. Knife Skills, a mini class to chop like a chef, because you've got to be handy with the steel, if you know what I mean, earn your keep. The first 1,000 people to use my special link, school.sh/SteveMold11201, will get a free trial of Skillshare Premium, no strings attached, and it's less than $10 a month after that. The link is also in the description, so check out Skillshare today. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, don't forget to hit subscribe, and I'll see you next time.